Edward on support.
On the red side, we have Super Hot Crew with Mimer in the top lane, Impaler is in the jungle, Selfie as the mid laner, Mr. Ryle is the AD carry, and of course, Weevil Failure is the support.
So let's take a look then at a last look here of the votes from lolesports.com for today's games. According to those numbers, you've called it for Gambit by 60%. Considering current form, yes, Gambit did beat Fnatic yesterday, but looked a little bit ropey in doing so. The Copenhagen Wolves win for the Super Hot Crew was certainly dominant. 60-40 for Gambit is still a fairly large number, I think, considering current form.
I mean, we could say 50-50 here. Both teams have shown on a good day, they actually pretty much look like, especially Gambit, against SK Gaming, when they had a very good day in the early game and just destroyed SK there, people were like, okay, Gambit, they're not done yet. They're still great players. And that's what everyone thinks, at least. Super Hot Crew has the ability to do the same as long as they have a good day.
So let's get into champion select then and see how this one is all going to go down between the Copenhagen Wolves. They already played today. Super Hot Crew and Gambit Gaming. Gambit, of course, on the blue side, get first ban, first pick, and that first ban will be Nidalee. Selfie, we have to give him credit while we're here because he's been bringing out a lot of new champions. In fact, has played 5 different champions in 5 games. The last one against the Wolves was Nidalee, where he finished 4-0-10. That's banned away. Yasuo has also had the chance to play against Alliance and dumped on them, I think it's safe to say, from a great height, finishing 8-2-8. That'll be banned this time, though.
He's actually been a pretty scary mid laner to face because he has these few key champions for him where he performs really well. 2 of them are now banned away, so wisely enough by Gambit, they target towards him. Trying getting on something, let's say a TF, where he had a lot of issues in week 1 against Curb in the early game, gave up some very easy kills actually. So maybe Gambit want to push him on to one of these champions where he won't be able to just sit on a comfort pick.
So Twitch banned away, the final ban here for Gambit. Doesn't seem to be a champion that Genja is so willing to play, and it's funny Genja because we've seen him so often. When Caitlyn was a flame, he never wanted to play Caitlyn. Now it's Twitch and doesn't want to play Twitch whatsoever. That'll be banned away. Of course, Redside, Cassidy banned, and Jax's taken away from Darian, who did really, really well on it against Fnatic yesterday. First pick then for Gambit as he comes around, Shyvana for Darian.
So with Shyvana being locked in here, which actually has been the go-to top laner for Mimer, especially when Jax was banned away, we need to see if he wants to go for Trundle, maybe he wants to go for Renekton and try and do real early game setup here for Super Hot Crew and just try and snowball this Renekton early on, put Darian completely out of the game and just try and win the game within the within like 30-35 minutes.
Well, see about that one. The Super Hot Crew, will they take a bottom lane here as their first two choices? Top lane already locked in, so they could possibly leave that for later on, depending on how things go. Lucian for Mr. Rawls. He has played every game apart from the win against Alliance on Lucian, where he played Draven in that victory. They will take the full bottom lane. And whilst we're talking about Mr. Rawls being great, I want to focus on Weevil Failure a little bit more here, because with Thresh, he has set up a hell of a lot for the Super Hot Crew.
His mechanics have improved a lot from when he was on Lemon Dogs 1 year ago in the summer split, where he had some issues when it came to actually landing the skill shots. He's improved it in solo queue over the last year, and he's actually landing a lot of hooks. We also see Leona play, very good at engaging team fights, so it's a great support pickup here for Weevil Failure. And of course, Mr. Rylas on Lucian. Nothing new. We know what he can do on it. We know he can carry games.
So the other side for Gambit then, what's going to be locked in here? Possible Elise. If we look down Gambit's choices so far in the jungle,
Sin is also open.
He's been in those 4 that we've been talking about all week long here. The Elise, Lee Sin, Evelynn, and Kha'Zix. In fact, played 1 from all of them there. And Lulu possibly here for Nick. He did play it yesterday against Fnatic. Had a bit of a horrible time in laning, but he's got dumpstered really by Pekka in terms of farm, but we saw as the game progressed that he became stronger and stronger. Actually didn't die in that game going 2-0-8. That's what he gets this time around.
And this Elise pick here could be because they want to focus on, again, disengaging fights, of course, with Lulu, with Elise, and also focus on pushing down towers. Because Elise, she's one of the few junglers who can actually attack from range and therefore get a lot of damage onto the towers while staying back. Don't have to go into melee range, which of course Lee Sin would have to do. Could be the reason they don't pick the Lee Sin, because normally Diamond would love to just maybe even first pick a Lee Sin.
So Lee Sin, as while we're on that topic, was locked in by the Super Hot Crew for Impaler. He did bring out Lee Sin a couple of times
twice
in our
believe.
Initial week, which was the first loss to Millennium, and then the win over Rockhat. Also gonna see Kale brought out for Selfie in the mid lane. He played that one in the loss to SK Gaming in the third day of the Super Week 1.
But so, for Super Hot Crew here, very standard picks, to be honest. I mean, Lee Sin, we see him pretty much every game. The dual lane is the same. Kale has been very popular lately with the Hurricane build here. So Super Hot Crew going a very standard comp. And Gambit then, with now KVM being logged in, really going for this tower pushing setup here. You have Edward on Gragas now to disengage. You have Lulu to disengage. You have the net from Caitlyn. You have Elise, of course, can land a cocoon and then run away, repel away. So there's a lot of disengage from Gambit here. And then you have Darien doing his stuff up in the top lane, just applying a lot of pressure, forcing Super Hot Crew to send people up to try and kill him, while the rest of the team can just push down towers.
What will the Super Hot Crew put against Shyvana this time around? If I look to previous games where they're against Shyvana, there's only one of them that was against Millennium in the opening game of the season. Irelia was the choice, actually, for Mimer. It's not going to be Teemo, I'm afraid, guys. Sadly enough, that would be a spectacle, that's for sure. But I do not believe Teemo will, in fact,
do it, man. Do it.
And Mimer shook his head. He's like, no. No.
Please don't lock it in. Please don't lock it in.
Don't lock in Teemo, please. And, of course, the switch is away. Mundo, a champion which Mimer played a lot of in spring when he was so popular.
And in the start of the spring split, we also saw this matchup close to every single game almost with Mundo against Shyvana. We talk always about how Shyvana wants to go for the Blade of the Rune King, do a lot of damage onto Dr. Mundo, and Dr. Mundo just focuses full tank, wants to sustain it, and going into the real late game part is where Dr. Mundo becomes this unkillable beast who can just tank up all the damage in team fights. So Super Hot Crew here, with both Mundo, of course, with the Kale pick in the mid lane, also with Lucian as the AD carry, looking for a very strong teamfight combo, also going into late game parts. Gambit Gaming as well, not weak in the late game. Caitlyn is one of the stronger AD carries once you really start hitting a lot of items in the late game, but the mid game for Caitlyn is the weak point of her, and that's where Super Hot Crew can try and punish Gambit.
This is Gambit's chance as well to tie up the scoreline in the table overall with the Super Hot Crew. If they can win this one, both teams will be 3-for-3. We'll see about that one, and we want to know, of course, who you guys think came out ahead in the picks and bans. As usual, tweet at LOL Esports with hashtag GMBWin or #SHCWin, and we'll see if the lineups have managed to sway your votes a little bit from that 60-40 that we saw in favor of Gambit from the LOLEsports.com vote a little bit earlier on.
And I think actually this game is going to really come down to, first of all, the top laners, of course. Do we get Mimer with a great start so he can become tanky very fast, or are we going to see Darien instead really starting to dominate the one-on-one? And then also when you look at the AD carries here, Caitlyn for me is a bit of a weird AD carry still. A lot of the people in Europe don't actually like to play her because her mid game is so weak, but also a person like Genji, of course, who can make it work if he gets to the late game.
We're always gobsmacked with Genji, right? So it always seems to be one champion somehow behind and still plays Varus when no one else is playing Varus, and bringing out Caitlyn now at a time where no one else is really playing Caitlyn. We'll find out how it works for him here as Gambit take on the Super Hot Crew in our final LCS game of week 2. And as I said, an important one, a chance for Gambit to level things up in the table between these two teams, and therefore also a chance for the Super Hot Crew to take a bit of a lead over Gambit.
Of course, we also need to see Selfie on this Kale here. We know how strong Kale is in the late game. In general, Super Hot Crew, they're good actually, except for maybe the real early stage with this Dr. Mundo here up in the top lane, but then actually already going into mid and then of course into the late game, they just have an overall very strong comp. And then to help the Mundo in the laning phase, Impaler with Lee Sin of course can be very active, or they can try and go for a lane swap and just have Mimer farming the jungle with Impaler.
That is a deep ward from Mimer. I want to see where the lane swaps come in. Gambit saw that one coming down. Not often we see wards quite that deep, and there is the vote, and it definitely has swung. 57 to 43, is it just another tick there for the Super Hot Crew? And of course it was 60-40 from LOLEsports.com in favor of Gambit before. So a little swing in the favor of the Super Hot Crew, seeing their picks. And let's be honest, they are on some comfort champions here.
They are, definitely. We also need to see with Gambit here how they want to use their siege comp. If they just want to get a small lead early and just start grouping up four members and just pushing down towers. We need to remember with Kale, you won't be able to instant clear waves. Like, you need a bit of time to kill all the minions here, so they need Mr. Rylas in the mid lane to help clear out the minions. Otherwise, Gambit is always going to get a lot of damage onto towers.
I'm expecting Selfie to go into the now popular Hurricane build with that KO later on. So it takes a little bit of time to get that way, so be a while before we're talking about that one. For now, the Super Hot Crew are taking away the blue buff, and Darien, not for the first time this season, he's on the other side of the map. This time, though, he will come around to safety. Of course, he got caught out, I think it was against Millennium, possibly, or even against Alliance, where he ended 1-9-4. I think that was the start of a bad snowball against him that game.
Well, he actually went in here to ward the red buff, just to spot out when Impaler. Marmar decides to go up and do it after this Wraith camp here, and then just return back to the lane. He should actually be running around though with Diamond and just farming away, yet he's staying in the lane trying to catch a bit of CS, but it's going to be very hard for him against both Weevil Failure and Mr. Rylas.
So this mid lane, early push out from Selfie, who hits level 2 slightly before Nick, and will try and utilize that extra leveling that he's gotten him for a bit more damage and harassment in that mid lane. Of course, has himself the heal to come out with as well. See how that one all develops. As you mentioned, this top lane, Darien doing something that's become less and less popular for this exact reason here, and staying around in that top lane.
So he did get level 2 at least for the dive, and we actually see Edward and Diamond coming in towards Selfie here.
Oh, the Ignite is going to go down. He's on the right side of the map from this one, and here is the dive onto Darien. He's actually going to be forced to flash away. Impaler trying to chase through, and Selfie now headed to the top lane. He's like, okay, can't get back to base maybe. I'll try and get back to the rest of my team as Gambit come around to this top turret. They're going to try and stop that one from going down.
They should be able to. Edward joining in as well, so it's 3 members against 3 here. We'll be able to clear the wave very, very fast. Mimer teleported down to this bottom lane here to pick up some farm because it's only Genja. So now Mimer can actually farm 1v1, which is very good for him.
Getting that farm to come his way, and should go ahead of Darien, who gets hooked into this one. Flay will knock him back. No flash, of course. Ignite went down, and Mr. Ross going very aggressive there. Not enough damage, though, in the end to finish off Darien.
Very aggressive. Teleport is ready for Darien, so you can just join in again with Edward and Diamond, of course, to continue to farm away in this one. So Gambit, they actually leave Genya to just farm early on here. They really want him to get ahead early so he can get into his late game point where Kaden, of course, will be very, very strong, and where Super Hot Crew instead actually put Mundo to get into this late game point and get the farm.
Funnily enough, Mundo, same CS here as Darien Shyvana, so
it is hard though for him to farm against the Caitlyn in a one-on-one, but still, gonna pick up some solo XP and at least try and get some of the farm with the Cleaver.
See there, Genja utilizing that Piltover Peacemaker and a headshot and auto attack, which will certainly knock some HP away from Mayo. But look at this, Selfie now, headed towards this bottom lane. Will Genja get caught out? He's got no ward. Selfie's level 4. Genja does have flash. Oh, that maybe have stopped this one from happening. Depends how effective this slow is going to be. Ignite will be put down here by Selfie. He's got his auto attacks going. One more will do it. Selfie picks up the first blood. And that's always the danger of leaving your AD carry alone.
Especially when he was this far up the lane, there was no ward to spot Selfie moving from the mid lane. And as soon as he actually moved away, Impaler just walked into the mid lane to pick up the farm, made sure Nick couldn't actually move anywhere or push just the wave down. It's a very, very smart play by Super Hot Crew, and really punishing Genja for being so far up in this bot lane all alone.
The top lane, if we look there, still 18 to 19. Mundo, of course, now will have some free farm, but he needs to be careful because Diamond has come around, and Mimer running his own health out here will actually take a good route, but that's a good cocoon from Diamond. Can he get in from this one? Has he got enough to finish off? He's got the vision. Impaler coming around. Mimer goes low. They actually try and turn it around, and Diamond's going down. Impaler gets the kill, and Mimer walks away with his life.
And notice how Impaler played the situation here. He actually walked down, then he just waited around the corner, so Diamond didn't even spot him coming, and then as soon as he went in range for the Sonic Wave, easy hit there from Impaler and managed to pick up a kill. Very, very strong start from Super Hot Crew. And now Edward, coming towards this mid lane, there's no flash on Selfie.
What is he going to be able to do here? Belly Slam will have to land, and that makes it a lot easier. A lot of damage coming in, but intervention will mean that he can walk back out of the lane. Didn't have his flash available. I used that earlier on, of course, to secure the kill on towards Genja. survives for now.
A little bit unlucky for Gambit there. Selfie actually managed to get level 6 on the very last minion before Edward showed in the lane. So of course, as soon as they saw he hit level 6, couldn't actually go for the kill. At least, Edward tried, forced away the ulti from Selfie.
Edward going back into the top lane now to help out with Darien, who does have a 5 CS lead over his opposite number. Maimer, there was a hook coming through, which Edward would have had to be called in to support. In the end, Edward will just leave Darien alone now and probably feeling okay. He's level 5, probably going to be hitting level 6 pretty soonish, which gives him all the more safety to deal with this Nick. And oh, Impaler comes over the top of the wall, didn't even see he was in range there. Can he finish off Nick? No, not quite. Nick putting down a ward. Not sure really why.
He's scare him away, man. Scare him away. Impaler, actually, if he had waited for his ED and flashed after him, he wouldn't manage to pick up the kill, but I don't think he expected Nick to just flash instantly away here. And very aggressive start from Impaler, being doing a very good job being at the right place at the right time.
And this is what he said early on in the Super Week, that yes, Lee Sin is a great champion for him because he loves to be aggressive early on, and that's where Lee Sin is going to be excelling. It just needs the coordination in the team to actually be top-notch so that he can actually pull that through and come out on top for his team. Looking like the Super Crew may get the first turret of the game away here as Darien tries his best to hold on to it, and at least for this wave, that turret will survive.
Yeah, Gambit is losing out on this lane swap here because, first of all, Edward left Darien now to 1v2 in his top lane, so the tower will take damage every single time Super Hawk Crew pushes in. And he went for a small roam towards the mid lane after he recalled. Of course, there was nothing for him to do there because Nick was so low. And now he's just down in this bottom lane, but it's going to take Gambit some time before they can actually kill the bot tower because Maimer, of course, kept Genji away from it for such a long time. So it actually barely took any damage, maybe about 40% damage or something. So for now, Subaru can take the top tower in case they want, and then just go down bottom lane and therefore make sure that Gambit won't take the tower.
Well, it looks like they may in fact go straight down bottom here. We see the recall coming out. Impaler coming to the top lane. You look at the health bars and you see that Impaler might have a bit of a tough time holding off Darien there, but with the safety of being underneath his tower, will certainly help out. And this is where it gets interesting when Darien starts to go into the enemy jungle between the towers. We all know that Darien sometimes gets caught out. Sometimes as well, it is for the greater good, let's call it.
Of course. I mean, sometimes he gets a dragon for Gambit just by pulling multiple members up top here. And what Subaru Crew actually did was send the bottom lane or the dual lane down to the bottom lane here because Genji was actually freezing the wave early on, so Maimer, he was zoned away from all the CS, and they needed multiple members to stop the freeze, so they had to recall up top, send the dual lane down to bottom lane. That's why Genji broke the freeze now, and that's a big wave for Mr. Riley. Gambit, however, will be able to pick up his dragon, because Impaler was still stuck over in his top lane. So yep. Darien, it worked for him.
Looking into the future there, and Darien says, yes, and he didn't even die for it this time as well. That is sweet, sweet times for Darien and the dragon, which brings Gambit back. When you look at the gold totals. Meanwhile, Mr. Ross taking a big hit down the bottom lane. Actually, it was the ultimate that came out of Genja that really knocked him low from that.
He was forced to farm under the tower once he actually came down to the lane. So there's a lot of poke from Gambit, as you said, ulti used as well from Genja. So all the summoners for the dual lane of Super Hardcore here. Diamond just staying around. Nick as well actually moving down towards them.
Will this be a 4-on-2 dive? They've pinged in the brush because they know there's a ward there, and Diamond's actually going to come through the lane. That makes it a lot harder for them to retreat. The box going to go down from We Will Failer. Cocoon not actually landed. There's a hook onto Edward. He's underneath the tower. They do manage to get Mr. Roz. Will they get We Will Failer as well? The rappel from Diamond comes in. Oh, last second intervention. Diamond goes down. He did get We Will Failer on his way out, though. No one else there, though, now from the Super Hard Crew to help get any more kills. They did hold the turret, but it's a 2-for-1.
2-for-1 here. Good aggressive move by Gambit. Diamond, he knew the wall was there, so he moved all the way around. And Maimer, because he was standing right in front of Darien, he couldn't teleport down to help. He would have been interrupted by the ult here from Darien, so he couldn't help the team. Therefore, two members went down. Selfie managed to get a kill, which is, of course, is very good for Super Hard Crew, but still gave up two here.
Stinger already in there for Selfie. And look at that, Impalo is coming around. Edward needs to be careful. He body slam gets him back behind the tower. And he's going to try and farm a little bit up here whilst his AD carry is gone. May just miss most of them as well. That's the case. Seems to be. He's got his barrel.
Oh,
there we go.
He got it.
Nice bit of gold for him.
And very, very good move by Gambit, actually. Selfie were the first one to move down bottom to kill Genja. Now Gambit did the exact same thing to the dual lane of Super Hot Crew because they got so low under the tower. So just overall a very smart move. Nikki pushed out the mid lane and then moved before Selfie even figured out what was going on.
I think this time around we saw him in his first game of the season, 0-0-0. Didn't really have much impact in the game whatsoever, as you would expect when someone finishes the game at 0-0-0. However, he has come into his own here a little bit more, I think, and looks to be feeling more confident in his role in this mid lane. Obviously, big shoes to fill as well. Certainly from a fan's standpoint, everyone, of course, loved Alex H. As Impaler goes in on towards Diamonds. A lot of damage. Kick comes around. There's a burst from Selfie that'll get them the kill. And now they're looking for Nick as well.
Edward
will come around. There's the damage. Impaler flash. Intervention won't save his life. There's a kill for Nick.
Intervention was way too late from Selfie. All the damage were already done from Edward, and then the intervention came in. So easy enough for Nick to just pick up the kill. First though, it is Impaler going aggressive onto Diamond. Again, this Lee Sin pick here has been very good for Super Hot Crew and applied a lot of pressure on the map.
That leaves them 4-3 up in kills, but slightly behind in gold now. Only 200 or so though, so not exactly a massive amount, as Darien once again was just going up towards the golems, and this time will be recalling. He started triple Dorans with one shield and two blades. Other side, Mimer. He's already got himself that giant's bell.
And while Gambit actually fell slightly behind in the lane swap in this start, as soon as the swap came from Super Hot Crew, Gambit actually took full control of it. The dual lane down the bottom here, Genji and Edward did a very good job getting Mr. Rallis low so they could dive him afterwards and kill him. And up in the top lane, Darien actually pulled ahead in farm against Mimer. Yes, he just lost the tower, but still it was already very low from the lane swap itself. So Gambit doing a very good job, first freezing the bottom lane so Super Hot Crew had to swap around and then just punish Super Hot Crew for it.
Gragas support causing a couple of issues from Mr. Rawls, really zoning him out with those barrels that even here without it, you know, with the support Gragas still definitely do cause a little bit of pain. Genja also pushed up quite heavily here as Lee Sin trying to get in. There's a ward in that brush though, so even if he gets past the vision of the minions, he's got to be a lantern gank indeed.
Has to be, but we will fail it. There's no flash, so he needs to land the hooked in to actually get the engage on. Darien now, full control of his lane. A level ahead of Mimer, just takes the tower, doesn't even care about Mimer.
No, no need to. Got himself a cutlass. No magic mantle as well on that last trip home. Sunfire Cake was the starting choice for Mimer, though, over with Dr. Mundo. Mid lane, which is, I want to say being quiet, but only really being quiet between the two of them. Otherwise, we've seen like a lot of roaming down from Selfie. 3-0-0, Darien, after saying that he's done a good job in that top lane, will actually be forced to use his ultimate to get out of the enemy jungle.
To use the Olden Way, of course, to let his flash and teleport. Dragon comes up in 50 seconds here, so he can go back. Shop now either run straight towards the dragon, save his teleport, or he can move up towards his top lane if Mimer's actually pushing down the wave towards him. Seems for now he's just holding it where it is. And once again, action down his bottom lane. Genji used the ulti, and now the rest of the Gambit is here.
There's a ward in there. I actually feel like they could have gone for that one, but they didn't know where Selfie was.
Have to respect the teleport for Mimer as well. They knew Darien was far away, and Mimer could join in at the tower here and turn things around.
Well, it's probably going to be called to join in either way because you've got 20 seconds until the next dragon of this game comes into play. A bottom wave forced up onto the turret. We already saw a couple of men from Gambit there, but although they've already backed away back to the middle lane and the jungle for Diamond, that's a lot of damage to Weewolf Failer. Again, the Piltover Peacemaker coming in, a lot of damage onto Weewolf Failer. But dragon is now up. Gambit got the first dragon of the game. Super Hot Crew knew it was happening as they had a ward in that death rush and chose to leave it.
Watch it though from Gambit here. We don't actually know Super Hot Crew started it now. Real fella, he's dead.
He's dead. He's gonna go down to that one. It's actually Genja that gets the kill. Dragon in the meantime went to the Super Hot Crew. They're gonna try and close down here, or will they try and get themselves away? I think backing away is the only option really, as we are gonna see them moving in. Impaler gets a very early intervention.
Darien
going low. Mimer's here, but Darien coming in around the side. He's kicked away before he can ulti through onto them. And that is bad news. They're chasing Mimer, but he's Dr. Mundo and he doesn't care. Flashes over the wall to get away.
But still, Darien teleported behind the rest of Super Hot Crew there. Did a lot of pretty much panic from Super Hot Crew as soon as he came in there. They spread up in every single direction. Mundo went up towards the river. The rest of Super Hot Crew tried to get back to the tower. Notice here with the teleport active, we're just gonna see the kill on Weaver Failure. first. Meanwhile, this is happening. Subaru is doing the dragon, and therefore Wheel Failure. I would actually say he stayed too long. I'm not sure if he tried to bait them to stay in this bottom lane so they wouldn't try and stop the dragon, but ended up cost his life.
So the TP. Let's have a look where exactly or not. Where that one came from. Either way, he came down the back, couldn't get his ultimate off in time. That's how it went down. Either way, it was the dragon for the Super Hot Crew. They're still behind you in this game, though. Right, about 400 gold. Still a lot of towers, though, up for grabs here. Only one apiece taken down, both of them in the top lane. As we see, Darien forged himself a CS lead now in this game. And we all know that Darien, even when he's 0-9 in some games, still looks very, very confident. They're going to go on towards We Will Failure. Intervention is available, not even needed at this time. And there's Darien appearing again from the backside. Wild Growth will knock up Selfie. He'll have to use the intervention on himself, but he's slowed and he's not going to get away. It's Darien that gets the shutdown.
So a lot of CC here from Gambit. As soon as they get onto Selfie, there's a slows from Edward and Nugget, of course. Cocoon landed from Diamond as well. So Selfie, even though he had Flash, couldn't even get close enough to actually get over the wall and decide not to use it. So Gambit again, because Darien has so much control in this top lane, he can just roam around like he wants to. So even though there's a fight down here, it's actually Darien moving down behind him and just coming in, doing a lot of damage, Wild Growth onto him as well to knock Selfie up, and they can just take him. Now onto Impaler.
Oh, wow, that was a great barrel out of Edward. And Impaler, will he get away? Wow, good kick out there. Darien getting hooked as well. And Impaler survives the turret, and however, won't be as lucky. And We Will Failure may be a little bit too deep here. They've got Mimer coming around. Yes, he's Mundo. No, Darien doesn't care. Just runs straight through him. Backs away.
And we actually saw here with Edward, when the lantern was down, he just placed his big fat belly right in front of it, so Impaler couldn't actually click on it, and therefore he had to just flash away instead of taking the easy route out. So nice play by Edward, and again, very aggressive Gambit here. They, as soon as they see an opportunity, they go for it, and really use the fact now as well with Darien, just completed playthrough on King. He can just go back to this top lane and do the exact same thing. Push Mimer down, roast it down to mid lane or whatever he wants, wherever he wants to go, and just join in for fights.
Looking good here for Gambit. Nick, who, again, has felt quiet so far during this game, but if you look at his score, he's been involved. 5 out of the 6 kills that Gambit have. He's got 2 kills, 3 assists from them, so being heavily involved in all those as a hook comes through wide, though, off Darien. Blade of the Ruin King start, which I think Quickshot mentioned it earlier. Most of the Shyvanas here in Europe have been starting off some Fire Cave.
Well, it depends. I mean, it goes a bit back and forth. Against Mundo, I definitely like the playthrough on King start because it means it's so easy for Darien now to just do a lot of damage and stick to Mimer, out-sustain him as well, and therefore just force him out of the lane, like we've seen he's been doing so far. And I like it for him. And also, he has the Wild Growth as for protection if he does get in a teamfight while he's still squishy.
There is a turret for the Super Hot Crew down bottom, still 2 behind overall. And also a couple of 1,000 gold. I like how Genji's been utilizing Caitlyn so far, I have to say, in this bottom lane. Using the ace in the hole whenever it comes up, just to knock Mr. Rawls away. And that's how they eventually got to finish off that bottom outer turret. We've got 2 minutes until the next dragon comes into the game. Last one, of course, was contested. And actually ended with Super Hot Crew taking it, but losing a couple of kills in the process. So we'll see how this next one all comes down. Edward's already in position here to maybe get some vision in place.
Gambit still has to worry about Selfie here on Kale. Already completed the Hurricane now. Has 3 kills. Definitely don't want to give that over to Kale. We know how strong she is in the late game. So still have to worry about this point, about this part here. But they are ahead now. So in this mid game, especially with Darien in the lead, and also with Nick being pretty well farmed on his Lulu, Gambit can definitely force some teamfights if they want to.
If they want to, we'll find that.
They don't even. They can actually also just split push if they want. I mean, keep the 4 members in mid lane and just have Darien split push up in his top lane here. So, multiple options for Gambit. 1 minute till the dragon teleport is ready for both top laners by that time. So of course they can join in as well.
See, Self is actually 40 CS ahead of Nick, and a bit of deja vu from the game against Fnatic where Peke controlled him in terms of CS, but they still allowed Nick to actually get involved when it came to those team fights. Although, as you mentioned earlier on, a Kale is scary the later the game goes on, especially with 3 kills to his name. And now 1/2 minute until that dragon comes up, the Super Hot Crew are getting some deeper wards in there, starting off with the Tribush. In case anyone comes from bottom, that of course would be Genja, who's headed that way right now. They've got a pink in the death brush as well, so is that Edward looking to bait them out.
Please, we have seen the amount of CC, and here's the cocoon action onto Failure.
Oh, that's going to be some good damage. Not quite the kill, but good damage indeed. The Hawk's not landing. They're going to go for Diamond, though. He will simply repel away. Dragon not there to go to, so he'll come right back down. Actually, a lot of damage coming his way. Edward is there as well. Darion needs to use his ultimate, and finally does. They're going to surely get We Will Failure. Wild Growth comes in, but Darion being focused. Finally, the barrel out of Edward as well. That will disperse the Super Hawk crew, but Gambit so, so very low. Not much help, though, with the Super Hawk crew either. There's a lantern for the Super Hawk crew to get away, but this dragon, not sure it's going to be taken just now. We Will Failure getting through the ace in the hole. Gambit still there with Genja on full HP, yeah, and Nick pretty much full as well. They couldn't stick around for this.
Genja actually joined in pretty late for the fight. He was in the bottom lane when they went on for We Will Failure the first time. He had to run all the way up to the team here. So Super Hawk crew in the start were actually in a pretty good position. Darion went in, got Wild Growth, actually managed to flash away, and then Genji had joined in when Super Hawk crew had to back away.
Selfie coming around. He's the real danger man.
He still has ultimate.
Yeah, his ultimate is still there, which must be a scary thought for Gambit, although they've got the numbers advantage here and health advantage really as well. Only one of them a little bit low. Mima down to half, but he's Mundo, so his half is more than anyone else's half, that's for sure.
They can go mid here. Gambit, you can, if they want to just give up this dragon, just start sending at least one member mid to push it up. It's actually what Genji is doing now. If they want to contest this one, he has to run back down though.
He's going to start to run back down. Dragon, just over half health. He'll start to reset himself here in a second, and Super Hawk crew go in. Impaler smites that one down. Now possibly going to try and turn around. Nico was already miles away from that one down in the bottom lane.
So a bit of a split decision from Gambit. They sent Genji up to push the wave up to the tower in the mid lane. The rest of them actually stayed, or three of the members from Gambit stayed at the dragon just to see if they could maybe steal it. And Nick went down the bottom lane here, so gave up the dragon. Could actually send all the members to the mid lane, at least get a little bit of damage onto the tower and then moved away if they didn't want to fight the dragon anyhow. But still, managed to pick up some farm, and Super Hawk crew got a much needed dragon here, keeping the goal fairly even.
Yep, keeps them in this game, that's for sure. Now, just 8,200-300 gold behind. 23 or 24 minutes into this game. Gambit still holding the turret lead though, especially that mid lane, which is all the way down to the inhibitor turret. Nick is already pushing up the bottom lane as well, although he's already seen Selfie go down there to get himself some easy free farm. And talking about his wave clear earlier on, it's now become a lot stronger with the addition of the Hurricane.
So, if Gambit is sieging up to the tower, it's hard for him to go in and actually hit the minions here and kill them, but as soon as he has just a few seconds, he will clear the waves very, very fast. And of course, with the help from Mr. Rallis, Super Hawk crew should be able to take out these waves in case Gambit decides to group up. For now, they're actually just back to farming. Genji as well, farming with Darion over in the top lane here, while Edward, Nick, is actually also going towards Knight to group up. I was about to say how many members are sitting up to this top lane. For now, there's just blue buff and Super Hawk crew, and Gambit actually just farming away a little bit.
A lot of red wards on the top side of the Super Hawk crew's jungle, I think mainly to keep an eye on Darion, who's been running around there constantly, surprising them a couple of times by coming out from the backside of them. Actually, he's nowhere near them at this point. He's still in the mid lane, although he's going to be called down to bottom where Selfie had already pushed that wave all the way on through. He's already backed up because his blue buff is available.
Selfie can just return down to this bottom lane again and split push, and then we have my mob in the top lane, Selfie in the bottom lane. If Super Hawk crew can actually manage to push Gambit away from here and then take control of the map, they can do this 1-3-1 split push with Selfie and Mimer if they want to. For now though, they just want to defend the lanes, and therefore Selfie is back into this mid lane.
So Gambit starting their move up towards top. That way, really starting to push through. They'll get themselves a red buff pick up here as well. They couldn't quite get around to contest that one. Selfie trying to head them off as an ace in the hole will come through. Hits Impaler in the end, but he's got a lot of shield. Darion actually going to go aggressive into this one. Wild Growth will knock them all up, but they need the rest of the team in. Eddie smashing them all around. Mimer actually going to be the big focus here right at the front. And with four men or five men on him from Gambit, doesn't matter how tanky he is, he'll eventually go down. That was a big win in terms of health. However, Darion did go low as well. Super Hawk crew trying to push back.
And it was the two tanks here from both teams that took all the damage, therefore nobody actually went down. Mimer had to flash over the wall to get out. It was a pretty good engage on the Selfie. Forced his intervention very early on in the fight here, but then the rest of Super Hot Crew could just join in, and actually nobody went down.
Kills from that one. just showing how willing Gambit are here to really get going on. Certainly willing how willing Darien is to dive into the rest of the enemy team, although that's not really anything new from what we are used to seeing out of Darien. He's just gone back down to that bottom lane to push things out, but he may be called to middle here. Five men from the Super Hot Crew are going to go for this outer turret. Don't know what's going to stop them, because Mundo can actually hold it up, but that cocoon onto Weevil Failure may just be what they're looking for with a turnaround onto Edward. Ooh. A lot of damage coming through.
A lot of damage here, almost landing a hook as well from Weevil Failure onto Genja. Super Crew, they continue to pressure. They're going in.
Oh, Impale around the back. He's kicked Genja away, and he's going to surely go down. No, last second intervention. 18, the hole comes through. It's Diamond that gets the kill, and now Darien's in the middle of them as well. A little bit further behind, slowed down. It'll be a one for nothing, though. They'll take that any day.
So they traded the tower for a kill onto Impaler here, who tried to insect kick back Genja. He flashed away as soon as he saw the flash actually from Impaler here. So very smart play, and therefore didn't get kicked into the team of Super Hot Crew. Still though, tower went down. Darien didn't use his teleport. He actually ran the entire way from bot lane up to mid here to join in with the team.
So as we are about to hit the half an hour point of the game, let's have a look where the gold leaves us. 1,200, 300 gold lead for Gambit, and tower advantage on their side at just 4-3, so not a massive lead on that front. But we are going to see the Dragon coming up here in just over a minute's time, which could certainly sway how that gold looks.
Last whisper for Genja now. He has enough gold for it. He's just been farming up the entire time. Can sell his potion by the last whisper now. And get towards this Caitlyn point where he really becomes strong in the fights. And that's really what Gambit wants. Then you have Lulu to protect him. Unless Lulu, of course, wants to use the Wild Growth on Darien when he jumps in. But you can still kite. You have to slow from Edward. You have to knock back from Edward. The kiting, the slows from Nick. So can be hard for Super Crew to actually get onto Genji here in the late game team fights. Unless Impaler gets a good kick onto him.
I'm trying to stick to Edward, and actually Edward using his ultimate there to knock them back somewhat, but the Super Hot Crew already starting to close in on some with Impaler, with Weewolf Failure, but Eddie, for such a big laugh on that Kragas, he's actually managed to dodge pretty much everything they throw at him.
Dodging around. Good moves by Edward. Didn't actually invest anything for Super Hot Crew's side, chasing him down. Edward had to use the ultimate, of course, but still managed to get away from it.
Now Diamond. Focus off Super Hot Crew's attention. Good cocoon onto Weevil Failure. I don't think there should be too much of a follow-up from that one, although now the rest of the team are coming in. Diamond, will he get involved? Mimer gonna get hit by the next slowdown. And in the end, Selfie keeping Darien away. That is a lot of damage coming Darien's way. He might be forced to ulti. No.
And this is a scary point again for Gambit. Late game, nobody will be able to 1v1 Selfie on this Kale here. That's why, again, Super Hot Crew can do this split push. They can even send Mimer up the top lane if they want to. For now, it's the Dragon. Teleport coming in from Darien. He just went back to base to heal.
Dragon already down though in favor of the Super Hot Crew, and they're going to take the lantern away. It leaves Mimer all alone, but he's got his ultimate running, and Mundo regening super quickly up to full HP. That was a good pickup from the Super Hot Crew. Actually brings them level now in terms of gold, and Gambit looking to make a move possibly onto that mid lane.
They want to force the teleport out from Mimer, at least stop him from pushing in this bot lane here, so they apply a lot of pressure now to this mid lane. Will he teleport behind? Genji actually isn't there with his team. He's running down to this bottom lane, so it's only four members, not the AD carry from Gambit pushing off. A bit weird.
Bit weird, and could have been deadly if Weevil Failure have landed that hook. Genji taking the long way around on the backside of his turret just to be super safe with that one. Don't want to be getting caught out and giving up a kill. But as we said, that last Dragon for the Super Hot Crew now brings the gold back to pretty much bang level. We've gone past the half an hour point of this game. But any more big plays come out, or whether it's a case of settling down a little bit longer, farming up a little bit more. We already know that Selfie is going to be getting stronger and stronger.
He's got
a Void Staff now added in to his Gnasher's Tooth and the Hurricane.
It's going to be so scary for Darien if he tries to one-on-one Selfie. For now, though, Super Hot Crew moving all five members down to this bottom lane. No teleport on Darien, and he's recalling from this top lane, so he won't be there in time.
He's going to be coming late to that party, and the turret may already be gone. In fact, I think it will be already gone. That is absolutely decimated by the Super Hot Crew. That's the tie-up on towers, and also the gold lead swinging back to SHC.
So smart move by them. They, of course, know Mimer is already pushing the wave up in the bottom lane. They spot Darien up in the top lane. Instantly just moved down here, picks up the tower very, very fast. If Selfie goes for a Lich Bane as well in the late game, he can really also just destroy towers.
I think here in the audience, we've got two separate fan groups for Gambit and the Super Hot Group. see who comes out on top of that one a little bit later on, because right now things are so very even. The question is, as things develop, who will start to forge themselves to one of the lead games? Oh! He nets into it! He's not going to escape that one. We will
fail against it. What were you doing, Genja? He was trying to steal away the red camp all alone, I think, and then just got hooked. Beautiful hook by Weevil Failure, setting it up here. And they might... Oh, another one!
Diamond caught out. He's going to repel, but he's repelling to nowhere. Comes down. Oh, that's a great barrel, but it won't be enough to save him. Diamond going to go down. It's Mr. Riles that gets the kill. Two men dead. Will they go for Baron here, SHC? They've had bad experience trying to rush down Baron's.
There's no Ziggs and there's no smite from Diamond here, so they will start it. Darren can still jump in, try and steal it. Edward without his ulti. Nick without his ulti here. Gambit's gonna be hard, it's gonna be a risky one.
They're trying to hold on to this one. Nick is maybe the one to do the damage. Darren diving in the back of Baron's down at a third HP, and they force Impaler to back away from the Baron pit. They've stopped attacking the Baron, but the Baron's not stopped attacking them. Impaler comes in. We will fail, he's possibly gonna die to the Baron. No, he's survived, and Selfie has taken down Lulu as well. Super hot crew, so well done there on Baron.
Darren actually tried to just go straight for Impaler in the back here while the rest of Super hot crew were chasing the other members from Gambit, but Impaler managed to flash over the wall, then Sonic Wave back into the Baron pit once Darren actually joined him on the other side here. Didn't go down, smited away. Baron now from Super hot crew. Genji were completely out of position there. Great hook by Weevil Failure on both Diamond and Genja, setting up the everything for Super hot crew.
Yeah, you have to say, he was 90 caliber net was already underway. Weevil Failure predicting that one, the timing and right angle on it as well. And we said before, that Weevil Failure, the time you've seen him on Thresh,
the mechanics has been great.
Constantly been hitting important hooks for the team, and once again, setting them up, this time for a Baron. And whilst giving him credit, you also got to look at the other side of the coin. Why was Genja trying to do the Wraith camp right there?
Wraiths, man. You need the gold. That's my only explanation. I've actually no idea. The rest of Gambit were already back at Blue Buff, I believe, so he was just all alone. For now though, let's just give credit over to Weevil Failure for landing the hook, and of course to Barku for picking off the Baron.
Picking up the Baron and a gold lead with it. 52.2 to, let's call it 49,000 gold. Not the biggest of gold leads, but with that Baron Buffoni lead that they'll certainly be happy with as Impaler steals away that big raid. And they're putting down some good pressure now onto this inner turret in the mid lane. Selfie has picked up another item worth noting, Sonya's Hourglass for him.
He's getting out of control in this Kale here. He's actually on the bottom lane pushing up here, so Super Crew needs to disengage in this mid lane, just wait for him to push up the very big wave, and then they can move between top and mid if they want to. Doesn't matter which person actually goes down to try and stop Selfie from hitting the tower here, nobody can touch him.
Yeah, Genja was the one to go down. He started walking on the left side of his wall. Look at this, they've come around the back and Gambit realizing they can't fight them here. That two-pronged attack was just too risky for them. They back away and say, okay, I'm gonna have to defend this lane at least from our base. They've only got one tower left outside of their base, which is on the top side of the map.
We need to see here, I mean, again, with of course both Caitlyn and Lulu, they can hit the waves fairly easy, but still need to be careful for the hooks coming in from Weevil Failure. Maybe Impaler will try and kick someone back. And the poor ward there, the pink ward, won't actually spot it.
So, no, a little bit too around the corner.
Unlucky.
Unlucky, yeah. Always ward in the middle, guys, so that you can see around those corners.
They don't actually...
Unfortunate, to say the least. We'll see if that comes to haunt them. I honestly don't really think it will make too much difference on this one either way, but maybe I will be wrong on that one. We'll see. Sneak push again.
Look at the damage also.
Yeah, it's Selfie.
Yeah,
it
just hits the minion, just hits pretty much everyone around it as well. From you saw Nick went down to like, he took 40% damage just from Selfie as you clearing the minion wave because he stood too close to it.
Super Hot Crew just waiting for this top wave to finally start pushing through. We'll give that a gentle shove. Selfie will get himself Gambit's blue buff on his way through. And honestly, Gambit should just back away here. I don't think they can think about defending this story.
At least try and clear the wave.
Darren could stay around. Oh, he gets hooked. A Flay comes in as well. Here comes the rest of the ultis in. Edward trying to stay out, but he gets kicked out of position. And they're going to strip him down. Wild Growth actually coming through, but they lose the turret. They lose Edward. This is bad news. The box is down there. And once the rest of the team get involved, Gambit so very low. Diamond and Darien flashing health bars there. They need to back off.
And there, Genji was down the bottom lane to clear the wave, so he wasn't there with and they're going for it.
Intervention used there, didn't quite have the damage to finish off. They will get that turret as Mima going to tank up all the damage. Actually missed the roll, blocking Ace in the hole out of Genji, which was less than ideal, but the Super Hot Crew get the slow onto Nick, and that should be the disengage to allow them to back away from the base.
And they managed to get the tower down, so now there's an open inhibitor. They can go for it after they go back and shop now and heal up to full HP. And once they get this one down, the wave is pushed by itself. Selfie, of course, can go to one lane, follow members to the mid lane, and then just start pushing everything in here and forcing Gambit, like we just saw here, to split up to defend every single entrance into the base.
Looks like Genji wants the dragon. He's got some backup this time, so don't worry about that one. Yeah, he's safe now. That little bit of extra gold to their account, which brings it back to a 5,000 gold lead for the Super Hot Crew, the second Baron actually of the game, as Impaler does come across and find that dragon is gone. Where's the next target for them? Of course, they didn't take the inhib on the top lane. They only managed to get rid of the tower, so no super minions streaming through on the top side of the map just yet.
So if they don't feel confident sending all five members to just teamfight for the inhibitor, just send Selfie there. Because again, no matter who's going to go to one-on-one, he's going to win it. You'll always get some damage on inhibitor. Back away, do the same thing back and forth, while the rest of Subar crew just keep the members from Gambit busy in the mid lane or in the bottom lane. It's an option for Subar crew, but now they don't actually seem to go for it, or will they? Selfie is very far away, so same goes for Mr. Alice.
Well, Diamond saw them coming, it's like, nope, do not want. Same thing goes for the Lantern there from Impaler's side. He will rather safeguard off to his own ward. Definitely safer at that point. Oh, Genji doing a red buff on his own. Spots thanks to that ward. Luckily for him that was coming in.
Oh, Darien.
I'm not sure he's going to do what?
Well, who needs teleport late game anyway? It doesn't matter.
Doesn't matter.
Diamond is in trouble.
Yeah, Diamond is in a lot of trouble here. He's going to repel, but where's he going to go? Straight down on top of him. We will fail as Hook was actually aiming for someone else down on the further side there. And Darien, as we said, teleporting in. Not exactly the highlight of teleportation that we've seen so far in the LCS, that one.
No, it was pretty bad. It was pretty bad. However, Subar crew is waiting for the Baron to respawn. Can put up some pink wards, clear all the wards away from Gambit here, and then either bait Gambit to actually fight for it or just take it by themselves if they want to. For now, they're just pushing down mid lane, can then push the wave all the way down and then move up to Baron.
What they're going to do, maybe push that top lane as well, so that one's going in their favor. They've cleared out all the wards that Gambit had. Impaler's going to be running a bit of interference there through the jungle. Will they set up a trap here? They want more ward coverage and less ward coverage from Gambit, which is what they get. Ace in the hole is going to come through and decent amount of damage onto Weevil. Failure, most of it though shielded up by the combo that they have. Now they're looking for a kill. Who are they going to go for? Darien, probably not the target you want. Edward, certainly a juicier one as they do hook him in. He's going to fall very quickly. Actually throws his ultimate out there, but I'm not sure it's enough to actually save him. As Darien comes diving in from the side. Meanwhile, Selfie is hammering on towards Diamond. A lot of them so very, very low here. And the Super Hot Crew are going to want to chase this through. That's a good cocoon coming in, but the rest of the team managing to come through the slow from Mima, being a real pain. Genji stayed behind, and Genji will go down as well.
And Subar crew should be able to finish this game, or at least take down another inhibitor in the base here. They keep chasing.
They're going to keep going. Darien will have to flash away. Can they get in? Hook from Weevil. Failure doesn't quite land. Have they got the damage to get across? Good slow from Nick there. That will stop Weevil, Failure, and the rest of the Subar crew chasing for kills, but it won't stop them having the turret.
Take down the turret here. Again, remember, top inhibitor is open. They can go there afterwards. Very, very strong team by the Subar crew, really using this Kayle in the late game, of course, and also Mima just tanking up all the damage.
Mima doesn't really care at this point. Randuin's Spirit Visage got himself a Sunfire Cape, got a QSS even. Get out of there and the extra defensive stats that that offers him. Baron, of course, is live here, so Subar crew can once again bait around that as they did so nicely just a few moments ago to get that fight going.
And there's no teleport on Darien, remember, so he can't actually stay in the bottom lane to defend the super minions coming and then teleporting up to stop the Baron. So that's why Gambit now actually want to go and start it himself, maybe. No, just want to at least get a ward down and then possibly Beckman. Are they actually going to start it?
They've waited a hell of a lot of time. And
there's Mima teleport.
Mima's coming in from the side here. It's actually going to be TPing right onto the head of Darion in the end. There's Edward's ultimate came out real early. Not sure it was the ideal timing for the missile. Ra's going to throw the calling out. Edward flashes away from the damage. A selfie goes for Darion. Don't get that kill, but they'll transfer over to Diamond, who repels and comes right back down on top of them. Wild growth used, but he's not enough for the hook. Onto Nick again. We will fail a set in that one up. It's a double kill for Mr. Ra's now at 5-2-4.
Beautiful again by Subaru. Mimer so confident he can just tank multiple members from Gambit. Teleports in behind them, starts the whole fight. Good hook again from Weevil Failure to give them a kill. Double collection from Mr. Riles. Now Subaru pushing down again.
Second inhibitor will fall. That one was left open earlier as they took down that inhibitor turret. That leaves the base now a juicy target for them, especially with a Dr. Mundo this late on in the game who's going to get his ultimate running. First Nexus turret will drop. The focus now turns to the second one. That will fall like nothing, and the Nexus itself is finished off. The Super Hot Crew take down Gambit in the final LCS game of Week 2.
Very strong team fights here for Super Hot Crew in this game, and they managed to punish Gambit every time they made a mistake. That's why they actually got ahead. That's why they got the Baron when they called out Genja at the Rave Camp. Took the Baron afterwards here. It's a very nice play by Subaru. And also Selfie on kill here in this mid lane. Early on he picked up all the kills. Teamfight-wise, he was very, very strong. And of course, Weevil Failure landing the hooks left and right.
We see that Kale, such a strong pick time and time
it
again.
Is.
We say it that Bright Mage struggled earlier on the game, which honestly he didn't do this time around either. He had a good control even on the late phase. He was out-farming Link there as well.
Yeah. Some credit to Gambit, however, early on in the lane swaps, they actually fell behind in CS, but then because Genja managed to freeze the bottom lane, they forced Super Hot Crew to send their dual lane down to the bottom lane, and that's where Gambit actually took over in the early mid game. Darion won his lane up one-on-one against Mimer. Down the bottom lane, of course, Genja and Edward did a very good job getting Mr. Riles and Weevil Failure low, so they could dive them with Diamond and Nick, pick up kills for Gambit. Actually, he also got quite a gold lead, so Gambit there showed some very good moves after the early lane swaps here to really turn it in their favor. But then when it actually came down to the mid late game part, Super Hot Crew were just one step ahead and managed to punish Gambit.
Yeah, I mean, Darion had such a free roam on that top side of the map. We saw the Super Hot Crew place three or four wards on their own top side of the jungle just to see where Darion was, because he kept coming around, kept flanking them. Okay, we saw that Dud teleport and ultimate coming out of Darion in the end, but actually didn't die during that game if we look down the scoreboard. 1-0-2 he ended with that one, but again, the Super Hot Crew, Mr. Riles, once again mopping up everything that was given to him. Selfie got to the point on Kale where it's just almost impossible to deal with the damage that they can throw at you.
Yeah, and also Mimer on Mundo, of course, managed to pick up a lot of farm. Got so tanky, we saw him teleport into four members from Gambit, and there's nothing like they know. We don't even want to hit him because we know we're not going to kill him. We have to run away already. So, again, for Super Hot Crew, they have some very good individual players. And that's why they can make these plays here. And that's why as soon as they see an opportunity, they see the enemy team make a mistake, they will punish you. Remember Rocket in week one, they were Super Crew actually behind. Rocket went for the Baron. Super Crew was like, okay, walk up, punish them, kill them, take the Baron, win the game. So they're very good at reacting to what's happening on the map. And then, of course, team fighting itself is something they're very good at.
It's funny as well because we heard from Impaler yesterday and Shox asking the question, who's calling for the Super Hot Crew right now? And he said, whoever shouts the loudest, basically, is what happens.
Of him and Weevil Failure. Whoever shouts the loudest, they will listen to. And if the guy shouts twice, nobody will say a thing. Just do what the guy is saying because he clearly knows what he's doing.
I'm not sure that's the most perfect way to call in team fights, but it seems to be working for the Super Hot Crew now. Four wins, two losses. Their losses came against Millennium in the first game of the season, where Millennium were looking brilliant. They've lost to SK Gaming, who are arguably the second, or you could even say best team around right now. Alliance, of course, had something maybe to say about that one a little bit earlier on. But for the Super Hot Crew now, with wins against Alliance, against Rocket, against the Copenhagen Wolves, and now against Gambit, they are looking incredibly good.
They're definitely looking like a top four team in Europe. Diamond predicted last split. He said this team here, they're some good players. I mean, as long as they get the teamwork and synergy going, they can really start becoming a top team in Europe, and that's what they're doing now. And of course, we have to remember last split, they had a very good period as well, and then they actually stopped and just lost a lot of games in a row, I believe. In the very last Super Week, they actually lost every single game they played. So we still need to see if they can keep this very, very strong play going, or if they're going to drop up and down, up and down, up and down, like some European teams, or maybe pretty much every single European team normally does.
Consistency, the name of the game for the Super Hot Crew. Shocks and Quick Chat are standing by to talk with the Super Hot Crews. We will fail it, so let's send it down to them.
Thank you very much, Joe. We are indeed happy to be joined by We Will Failer, actually, for the first time in the Summer Split here in the LCS. Of course, we've already seen you playing last year when you were on Lemon Dogs. How has it been coming back into the LCS and gelling with this team?
Well, it's really awesome. I mean, like in Lemon Dogs, it was completely different. Like, it was a really different scenario. It was my first time. And with these guys, it's like everything feels right. They wanted me to join the team instead of like just making it myself. And yeah, that feels really awesome.
How has it been transitioning for you and the team, considering you did replace Mixer from the Spring Split now to the Summer Split? What's the vibe like in the team, and how did you adjust?
Well, me and Rallas have played before together, so it wasn't really a hard transition for me. Like, we had to just learn to play together on the bot lane, get used to each other again. But before the rest, like, the team had a straight plan. I gave my input on the plans, and it was really easy to just fit in.
Let's focus on this game. You mentioned that synergy with Mr. Rollin. You also mentioned to us before, I didn't do that good in the early game here. And also, Super Hot Crew was just really aggressive.
Yeah, I don't know. Like, the early game was a bit hard for us. We did a really good early game, but then they out-rotated us to bottom, and they dived us, and we lost advantage, and Rallas was, like, two levels behind. I was not really capable of doing anything because Edwards Gragas was, like, awesome. So, yeah, it was really hard for us.
I want to ask you a little bit about that. During the Spring Split, if Mr. Rawls didn't have a good game, then the Super Crew wouldn't win. This game, Mr. Rawls was average. He really didn't shine, but the rest of the team seemed to step up and carry. Selfie in particular has had a very good week. What is it about this game that allowed the other members of the team to help you win?
Well, it's basically we have a straight plan, and with everyone stepping up, Impaler stepping up really big compared to last season, Selfie getting more used to being on the stage, that's really helping us. It's not about Rallas carrying or me doing good plays. It's everyone doing their part of the strategy.
Well, no, do not sell yourself short, because your Thresh is really good, and it was instrumental again because it went quite late again. So tell me how you guys were able to close it out, and why is it always so close for you guys?
Well, this game we picked up, like, we knew we did some mistakes and we wanted to put them, yeah, like we do our plan that we wanted to do instead of just like making mistakes and mistakes. And we said, like, yeah, now we need to do this, we need to do that, get good wards. And then in the end, it was like, okay, a good hook, we can engage. And then when we got ahead, it was just easy because we could just say, okay, just stick together, push out the lane, go mid, get inhibitor, and yeah, it was good.
If we step back from today's games and the games in general, what is yours and Super Hot Crew's goals? Do you feel Worlds is a very real possibility, or are you just playing to survive?
We're playing to win every game. We're not playing to be first, to second, to third. It doesn't matter. We just want to be happy with our performance and get better. It doesn't matter if we get Worlds or not, but of course, everyone wants to go to Worlds. So,
what would be the trick? What would Super Hot Crew need to do in your mind to qualify as one of the top three teams to go to Worlds?
Keep up doing like we're doing now. Just everyone looks at their mistakes, looks at their individual mistakes, looks at their team mistakes, and just be able to talk about it. If we can keep doing that, then no one goes mad over mistakes, and we can just work on them really well, I think we'd actually do it.
If we then take a look at the other teams, obviously you played a lot of players and teams already when you came into the LCS the first time. What would you say are the strongest teams right now, and the ones you should be most wary of in that race for Worlds?
I think definitely Alliance and SK, they're playing really well. Team synergy is going as they want it to be. They have the picks every game, so they're out-rotating most of the teams. So I think they're definitely the ones that are going to contend the spot.
I want to ask a question about those two teams. We know SK have got some analysts, the sports psychologists in the background. Alliance seem to be improving in their macro game. They've got these two mystery analysts that they refuse to name at this point in time. We know that Super Hot Crew has an analyst as well. How are you interacting with your team analyst, and how does he actually help your team?
Well, he tells us individual things about like runes and masteries if we need it. And as well, he's helping us with the strategies, which comp we're going to go. And then the most important thing is that after scrims, we just look into our replay together with him. And he's saying, okay, here you made a movement mistake. Here you could have moved the bottom instead. Here you moved, for example, back into the lane instead of going into that jungle. Here you missed the put a ward. That's the things that he's doing the most.
And what? How is life like in general? I think I recall that you guys didn't have a gaming house back with the Lemon Dogs. Now you're living with these guys in a house. I saw a very disturbing tweet of Impaler 2 weeks ago, I think, of something written on the bathroom wall. But how has it been living with this guy? It seems like a fun bunch.
Yeah, it's fun. These guys are awesome. And like, yeah, you got to imagine like five guys like us living in a house that just...
It sounds like a lot of fun.
Yeah, it is.
All right, well, keep up the good work, and thank you very much. Now we're going to send it back over to Joe and the Fish Show for a look at the table.
Thank you very much, Shox and Quickshot. So, guys, with week two now complete, here are the current standings of the European LCS Summer Split. Alliance have broken away from the pack and now in first place all by themselves at 5 wins and 1 loss. Then it's back into the Titanic table in second, where we have SK Gaming and the Super Hot Crew with 4 wins and 2 losses.
And in fourth place, we have Fnatic and Millennium, tied at 3 wins and 3 losses. And after that, of course, we have the Copenhagen Wolves and Gambit. They're tied together in sixth place at 2 wins and 4 losses. And down in the bottom, we have Rocket, who lost today against the Copenhagen Wolves with only 1 win and then 5 losses.
Yeah, the action really ratcheted up today. And well, today has been the dubious distinction of being the bloodiest four-game day in the European LCS so far, with absolute multitude of kills, real action-packed day. Over 100 kills, in fact, we had today, which is pretty impressive stuff. So let's take a look at our lineup of OP players who excelled in their positions this week while racking up that incredible number of kills. Starting off for our top laner, this time chose Mimer.
So last game he played here, we just saw it against Gambit. He went Dr. Mundo, got to late game part, where he just became this unkillable Dr. Mundo. And yesterday on Shyvana, he was unstoppable. He picked up 5 kills as top lane Shyvana here. Most of them even by himself in split push against Youngbug on Vladimir. So beautiful performance by Mimer this week, and he's really stepping up his play.
So into the jungle role then. From Alliance, we took Shook, integral part of their team.
This guy almost managed actually to carry Alliance in the early game by himself. But he doesn't need to, because of course every single lane for Alliance is doing so well. And it opens up for Shook now to just be everywhere he wants to be on the map. Set up kills left and right. He's managed to pick Lee Sin pretty much every game he actually wants to. And it's something teams need to be careful about, because his Lee Sin is just beautiful.
Oh, in the mid lane, we've just seen him in our last game going pretty crazy on that Kayle. It's of course Selfie from the Super Hot Crew.
Very, very strong performance. Nidalee yesterday, Kayle today, of course. Really liking these different kind of mid lane champions from what we saw last split from him, of course, where it was more of LeBlanc types. Now he's focused more on Nidalee. We have Kayle here, and it works for him. It works for Super Hot Crew. They're very good at going also to these mid late game points where they can focus on having Selfie, land some good spears, to just go completely crazy and Kayle here. And overall, he's actually been very consistent.
Very, very incredible performance from Selfie. Into the AD carries then, and again, another Alliance member. This time, Tab, so good this week.
So good, and this guy was a bit of a slump last split, but now this split here, he's really just stepped it up from the start. You see Alliance also building comms around saying, we know Tabs can carry on these AD carries here, so we can go Lulu mid. We know we won't like any damage here, of course, and it really works for Alliance. And him and Niff together as well, down the bottom lane, actually managed to pick up quite a lot of kills just in the laning phase, 2v2.
And in support, we just heard from there in the interview, again from the Super Hot Crew, we will fail her.
Pretty much one of the biggest playmaking supports we have in Europe at the moment. I mean, his hooks land left and right. He sets up kills for Super Hot Crew. His Leona has been great. We saw him in the last game again, landing hook after hook. Yesterday against Copenhagen Wolves, he caught out Kautzad multiple times, got Super Hot Crew ahead, and therefore actually managed to give them pretty much the entire mid-game, and they took it and used it and just pushed their advantage and won the game. So for me, we will fail her. It's really impressing me.
Really strong start to his career here with the Super Hot Crew, but of course one of those players managed to go above and beyond this week, so we are awarding the MVP to Shook. Brilliant play from him this week.
Fantastic play this week. Again, he got Lee Sin twice. It's been his main champion, and every single time he gets Lee Sin, we just see him set up kills, set up beautiful kicks into the rest of Alliance, and they can manage to get killed.
And we actually have a clip ready that highlights his performance this week, from landing first blood against Millennium to securing the last kill in a team fight against SK Gaming to clinch the match. Shook's Flying Monk showed iron will in both of Alliance's wins.
does jump in. He could get flayed straight away.
Oh. There it is. Just use it. There's the death sentence. Hooks him in. And Shock follows straight through with a sonic wave. This is a very, very messy fight. Shock in the middle of them. Going to try and kick Candy Pie in the back. Does do that. They're going to take him down.
Absolutely brilliant. I mean, the kicks over and over in combo with Niff, so good.
And this is what we've pretty much been told by all the Alliance members last bit about Shook here. In scrims, you're just an absolute monster. He would just make plays left and right, but we didn't see it in the LCS. Now this split, all of a sudden here, because everyone is doing well in the lanes, opens up for Shook to just make plays left and right. And I remember Froggen actually in one of the interviews telling us, Shook doesn't call anything. He doesn't say, I'm going to kick this guy back. He just goes in, kicks the guy back, and if you're not ready, the guy's going to escape. If you are, you're going to kill him instantly. So you have this jungler here who's just making some sick plays, and you don't even know when they're actually going to happen.
Getting himself a well-deserved MVP. And guys, of course, the action will continue tomorrow with week two of the North American LCS Summer Split. They will begin the day with Counter Logic Gaming versus Team Solo Mid. Real highlight start to the day, followed by Complexity versus Evil Geniuses.
Then LMQ will take on Team Dignitas, followed by Cloud9 versus Curse. And after the LCS matches, the North American Challenger Series quarterfinals will feature XDG taking on Frank Fang Gaming in a best of three. And those matches begin on Saturday at 9 p.m. Central European Summertime, which of course is 12 noon Pacific.
And the European LCS will continue next Thursday right after a brand new preview show. We'll kick off week three with Alliance versus Rocket, top versus bottom that game, and then SK Gaming will take on Millennium.
And after that, we have Subar Crew against Fnatic. Both teams won today, remember. And then Copenhagen Wolves will take on Gambit Gaming.
Of course, that all starts next Thursday, June the 5th, at 5:30 p.m. Central European Summertime, which is 8:30 a.m. Pacific. But right now, it's time for the European Challenger Series quarterfinals, where Shantou Machtwao square off against Gamers 2.
First and foremost, League of Legends is a very fun game. It's a MOBA, and it's like something that I very much enjoy.
I was pretty surprised. I was like, wait a second, you can actually make a living out of this in the future because it's getting so huge.
League of Legends for me is a measurement of my talent and my ability to show my hard work.
I'm prepared to change my mindset for being a well-known player.
If you qualify through the Challenger Series, you control your destiny.
Getting into LCS is a bit of a dream.
It's just something that I can look up to and say, I can get better at this. I'm not